Karibu, and welcome to The Link, Life in Christ, SDA Church, where we are connecting people to Christ. You're probably wondering, how are we connecting people to Christ? Well, you can join us every Sabbath morning until this crisis is over on Facebook by sending to me your email address, and you can contact me at vmorris56@icloud.com. And then you can also join us on Zoom at 11 o'clock for our kids' time, where we will have Sabbath entertainment for your children so that you won't get bored. So thank you for worshiping with us here at The Link, Life in Christ, SDA Church.
Thank you. Church family. I've missed seeing your faces and hearing your voices in person. I've missed the life and the energy that our kids bring to our church community. But one thing that has not been missing is our faithfulness. We have continued to be faithful despite being separated physically, and we have remained together in spirit. No mere virus can stop that. We're joined by the love of Christ, and not distance, not lockdown, not even technological breakdown can keep us apart in spirit. One important way in which our faithfulness has been on full display is in our giving. The reality that we are unable to gather has in no way impacted our commitment to giving. With two Sabbaths left in this month, we need about $1,300 to meet our monthly goal of $4,000. Over the last 2 months, we not only made budget, but exceeded it. So I have great faith that we will do so this month as well. This Sabbath's offering is for local church budget, and the Lord knows we need to support our local church budget. The options are Adventist Giving, go on our website, find Giving, click. Cash App we can use, $ SDA Church, or you can call the treasurer. So please remember, give generously, give lovingly. God loves a cheerful giver. Also remember to think about those who might be by themselves. Give them a call, give them a virtual visit if that can be arranged. Use this time to love somebody, somehow, some way. Happy Sabbath, church family, and be blessed.
God sent his son, they called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. And I
Hello and welcome, everyone. Happy Sabbath to all of you. I wish we were at the Life in Christ Church right now, but circumstances don't permit it. But I am glad that I still am able to share the message with you today. The title of the sermon today is Baptism for What? Let's pray. Father God, as we open up your word now, we pray, dear Father, that you might speak to us and that we might listen with all of our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. It was in 1997 that I found myself on a one-month military exercise, training exercise. At that time, in 1997, I was enlisted in the Army as a soldier. The exercise was being held at White Sands Missile Range near Las Cruces, New Mexico. I don't know if you've ever been out that part. Out there, it was very desert-like, and during the exercise, the one-month exercise, some Christians were able to get together for worship once a week with the chaplain or in Bible study. Interestingly, in my time there, I was actually approached by some genuine Christian sisters, other soldiers, stating that I was lacking one thing in my Christian walk. And when I asked them what it was, they said, speaking in tongues. Obviously, these sisters were Pentecostal and were seeing that this was an area that I could actually improve on. Out of respect for them, I searched the scriptures on every occasion where it mentioned speaking in tongues, and I prayed about it. Lord, is this you speaking to me? At the conclusion, I shared with them that I did not come to the same conclusion. But what if they had said to me that I was lacking in baptism? Could I have come back scripturally with a defense? What could I have said that the Bible, when the Bible states that Jesus was without sin and was yet baptized? What could I say? Could I argue with Jesus when he spoke with Nicodemus in the middle of the night and he said, you must be born again of water? Could I argue with him then? Surely there is a definite purpose for baptism in the Christian life. If not, why would Jesus say that we must be baptized? Open with me to the book of Luke, chapter 3. Luke, chapter 3. I wish I could hear those pages turning, but if you don't have your Bible right next to you, I'll give you a moment. Please grab it. Luke, chapter 3, because we're going to explore this purposeful experience that Jesus has for each of us through baptism. All right? Luke, chapter 3. And we're going to be starting with verses 2 and 3. But the point that that God is trying to make to us here is that baptism leads you to repentance and sin being forgiven. Baptism leads you to repentance and sin being forgiven. Let's take a look at scripture, okay? Luke chapter 3, verses 2 and 3, it says here, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. He went into all the country around the Jordan, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. Can you see it? It's pretty clear. Baptism leads you to repentance and sin being forgiven. Okay. A Sunday school teacher asked a class what the word repentance means. A little boy put up his hand and said, it is being sorry for your sin. And a little girl also raised her hand and said, it's being sorry enough to quit. Who do you think got it right? I think the little girl got it right. Yeah, she got it right. 1 point for the girls. How was it up to that moment during John the Baptist's time? I mean, if you sin, then you would bring a lamb to sacrifice as payment for your sin. Not payment for your sin, but you're sacrificing to pay for sin, right? The symbol of the Messiah. Yeah, yes, okay? But who called you to account for that sin? Did anybody? And if you sinned, just bring another lamb, right? Wrong. That's not what it was supposed to become. God wants to change. God wants change in our lives. We need to turn away from the way that we are living our lives if it's going contrary to what God wants. There needs to be, repentance isn't about face. It is a total change. That is what repentance is. It's a change. The little girl got it right, didn't she? In the process of repenting and confessing, God forgives our sins. That is our first step forward for baptism, repentance. And if we continue in sin, then the question is, was the repentance genuine? Okay. So the first step is baptism leads you to repentance and sin being forgiven. The second one, let's take a look. Baptism prepares the way for Jesus to walk in your life. Baptism prepares the way for Jesus to walk into your life. Let's take a look at verses, Luke chapter 3, same chapter, verses 4 to 6, okay? It says, As it is written in the book of the words of Isaiah the prophet, a voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him. Every valley shall be filled in, and every mountain and hill made low. The crooked roads shall become straight, and the rough ways smooth, and all people will see God's salvation. Are you seeing it? Baptism prepares the way for Jesus to walk into your life. That passage actually came from Isaiah. Luke is quoting from, actually John the Baptist is quoting from the book of Isaiah, exactly what the mission of Jesus was to be. Okay, so baptism prepares the way for Jesus to walk in your life. When you are baptized, it is not the finish of the race, is it? You're not crossing a finish line. There's not all these streamers. It's not the end. It's actually the commencement of the race. Okay, now it's time to run. But how do you run as a Christian? I remember struggling with learning this. How do you run as a Christian? Well, time with Jesus is how you learn to walk and run with Jesus. Okay, you got to spend time with him. This is the way the disciples learned, isn't it? That's where they learned as well. They spent time with Jesus. I love it because in the book of Acts, it mentions, by the way, that Peter and John, the way that they answered, that the Pharisees and the Sadducees could tell just by the way that they answered that they had been spending time with Jesus. They answered just like Jesus. Okay. I love it the way Paul puts it in Romans chapter 10 and verse 17. He's talking about the same subject. He says, consequently, faith comes from hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word about Christ. So learning about Christ, reading about Christ, all of these things help us to firm up our walk and our run with Jesus. I still remember the times of waking up early to spend time reading in the Bible, early in my walk with Christ. I would make it a goal to meet with him daily. Baptism makes your need of Jesus more apparent to you. You recognize that he is the one who will give you success. Okay? So, we've learned a second point. Baptism prepares the way for Jesus to walk in your life. And actually, we all have need of this, don't we? Okay? Our third point actually comes from, it says, baptism necessitates a change in lifestyle. Baptism necessitates a change in lifestyle. Verses 8 and 9. Look with me, okay? Luke 3, verses 8 and 9. Produce fruit in keeping with repentance. And do not begin to say to yourselves, we have Abraham as our father. For I tell you that out of these stones, God can raise up children for Abraham. The axe is already at the root of the tree, and every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire, right? Baptism necessitates a change in lifestyle, right? It does. Change in lifestyle? Wait a minute. That sounds like work. Is this walk with Jesus salvation by works? I know someone's thinking that. But God only necessitates changes that are contrary to his will for you to become more like him. Those are the things that God wants to change. So if my hang-up is alcohol, can I go on drinking and still continue to be true to him? Well, the answer is pretty obvious. No, you can't. Okay? True love requires action. Ask anybody who's married. True love requires action. If we truly want to follow Jesus, things will change in our lives. They will. They will have to change. Okay? According to what we learn about God. As we learn about God, the Holy Spirit gently causes changes to become natural in our life. Our palate for life and for activities change as you spend time with Jesus. Oh, well, I don't want to change. Maybe it's because you don't want to change because you're not spending time with Jesus then. It will change my spending time with God and everything. And this lifestyle change, right? It will change my interactions with others. I can't go on being a jerk and following Jesus, right? Treating people badly. In the movie, there's a great movie, if you can check it out. Great Christian movie called Do You Believe? Do You Believe? Excellent movie. There's a line that is shared that is convicting. I want to share it with you now. It says like this. I was once asked, if you were ever accused of being a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you? Man, that's a great question, isn't it? What a wonderful question. Do we let Christianity permeate all of our lives, private and public? Do we? Or do they just see you as the same old Valerie, Lillian, Sam, or Job? God wants to change you to be more like Jesus, okay? To restore you to the original programming before sin entered the picture. See, that's God's ultimate goal, isn't it? The fruit you produce serves as the token of authenticity of a changed lifestyle. Baptism necessitates a change in lifestyle. Well, there's one more point. It says baptism invites the Holy Spirit to prepare you for heaven. Baptism invites the Holy Spirit to prepare you for heaven. Read with me Luke 3, verses 15 to 17. The people were waiting expectantly and were all wondering in their hearts if John might possibly be the Messiah. John answered them all, I baptize you with water, but one who is more powerful than I shall come, with straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear the threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his barn and to burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. Are you hearing that? Baptism invites the Holy Spirit to prepare you for heaven. Baptism is that big start. Think about Pentecost. Think about what happened in Acts chapter 2. These people who were following God, who were baptized, were praying for his will to be done, and the Holy Spirit came in. Later on, other people who were baptized right after they were baptized, they received the Holy Spirit. In these cases, they were speaking in tongues. However, the reality is, that's not the only way that the Holy Spirit manifests himself. He manifests himself in other ways. I want to share with you something else. It was in the 1996 Summer Olympics. Sprinter Michael Johnson set records in the 200 and 400 meter race. To do so, he had trained for some 10 years to cut off a mere 1 second or two from his time. In his book, check this out. In the book, Slaying the Dragon, he writes, what a perfect title. Success is found in much smaller portions than most people realize. A hundredth of a second here, or sometimes a tenth there, can determine the fastest man in the world. At times, we live our lives on a paper-thin edge that barely separates greatness from mediocrity and success from failure. Life is often compared to a marathon, but I think it is more like a sprinter. Long stretches of hard work and spiritual discipline punctuated by great tests in which God gives us the opportunity to choose His eternal best. Are you inviting the Holy Spirit to truly direct your life? I can't think of a better illustration than this to share how the Holy Spirit's supposed to be at work in our lives. Daily, quietly, day by day, through prayers, through quiet times where we steal away to spend time with God, God begins to work on us, punctuated by the race starting when all of a sudden there's a catastrophe and God gives you an opportunity to have a straight back, have true faith, to be able to stand for God and make a difference, not only in your life, but in the lives of others that surround you, inspired by the Holy Spirit to do these things. Baptism invites the Holy Spirit to prepare you for heaven. These little things. Baptism is an important part of our Christian walk. Baptism gives purpose and priority to our walk with Jesus. God knew that we would go through storms that would shake us to the core, marriages that would look like they're about to fall apart, financial crisis that would cause us to question if we're going to make it, and epidemics that seemed to touch every corner of the world. God knew that in these moments, you would have to revisit the day in which you put your life into God's hands, the day of your baptism, the day when you made the decision that you would belong to Jesus forever. Today, in the midst of COVID-19, it is important to remember that you still belong to Jesus. Remember that you took that step of faith, and all we are waiting for now is for Jesus' soon return. If you haven't made that decision, I would recommend that you make that most important decision of your life today. Is there someone there at the home who's listening to me right now that would like to follow Jesus? If there's someone there, just raise your hand. God sees your hand. Is there someone? Maybe they're young. Maybe you need to rededicate your life. I don't know what you're going through. But if you're there, I'd like to pray for you. Let us pray. Father God, I am so grateful, Lord, for this time that you give us together. I'm grateful, Lord, for your love and your care. I'm grateful, Lord, that you made up something called baptism, that you put it into John the Baptist's heart. The simple thing of going into the water, giving ourselves to you, and us being tied to you. I pray, dear Father, for the hands that did go up. I pray, dear Father, for the decisions that are being made right now that only your eyes can see. I pray, dear Father, for those who have been baptized and have come to the realization, dear Father, that this baptism has such a great purpose in our lives. Please, dear Father, let your will be done, not only in our lives, not only in baptism, but with everything that's going on in this world right now. Let your will be done. If this is going to bring us closer to Jesus' coming, let it be. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. So glad that we got to worship together. I pray that you would look over Luke chapter 3 for yourself. Thank you, and God bless.
My rapture can tell. I know that the light of His presence with me doth continually dwell. In His beauty, the King in whose law I delight, who lovingly guards every footstep and gives me a song in the night.